This is one of the most amazing undercover stories of our era.
It could be the biggest fraud scandal to hit the Navy in years.
It's about a guy who corrupted the US Navy to its core. And amazingly, he agreed to talk to me for 25 hours for a podcast that I've created called Fat Leonard.
The owner of the Singapore-based Glenn Defense Marine Asia, known by his nickname Fat Leonard, bribed Navy officers with elaborate gifts, trips, and prostitutes.
Leonard told me in detail about how he effectively ran a prostitution ring inside the U.S. Navy.
Everybody was in my pocket. I had them in my palm. I was just rolling them around.
This is an incredible tale of fraud at the center of the most powerful Navy in the world.
When you are attending a $1,000 plate dinner, that is a bribe. Is that a $10 McDonald's?
Fat Leonard corrupted not just captains and commanders, but also admirals. The fact that Leonard was able to compromise, you know, so many Navy officers really is an embarrassment for the Navy, and it's also a national security risk. I'm Tom Wright. I'm an investigative journalist. For years, I've covered fraudsters, most famously Joe Lo, the fraudster at the center of the billion-dollar whale scandal. And now I'm digging into the Fat Leonard scandal.
Malaysian businessman Leonard Glenn Francis, known as Fat Leonard for tipping the scales at more than 400 pounds.
So Leonard Glenn Francis was born in 1964 in Penang, Malaysia, a small island. He came from a family of what are called ship chandlers. That's a job where you provide food and fuel to ships that would come in, and they did that for merchant ships. But Leonard decided, as a young man, that it would be much better if he could do the same for Navy ships, because they're much larger and the contracts are bigger. So he started to do that in the 1980s and into the 1990s, and he built up his business.
I was always very ambitious. Growing up, I always had a great ambition, you know.
He became, you know, exorbitantly wealthy.
What am I supposed to do, you know, just go live a humble life? Oh no, absolutely not. I'm a bigger than life kind of person, you know.
And he ends up living on Nassim Road here in Singapore, which is, you know, the most expensive road in the city, in a $130 million mansion. He has like 20 cars, he has a militarized Hummer. Leonard was a beneficiary of that crazy time when the defense spending from America was so huge. So Leonard Francis actually got in touch with me for this podcast because he wanted to tell his story, and we began talking in February. And I was shocked by how honest he was on tape. You know, every day we would talk and the recorder would roll and he would tell the story of corruption.
It's huge risk for me to, you know, do what I'm doing, but I'm so upset with it. Well, I'm portrayed as the bad guy when I wasn't the bad guy.
He was a contractor for the US Navy. That meant that he provided food, fuel, and security for them. But he didn't just do that, he also corrupted Navy officers with bribes of prostitutes, gifts, Chanel handbags for their wives.
Everybody has their needs. And, you know, I gave them that sense of confidence, and I also provided them what they wanted. And it was safe, and they could trust me, and I never let them down. You know, I played professional, I played sexual, whatever you needed, anything.
The Fat Leonard scandal is one of the worst ever national security failures for the US Navy. He would secretly put video cameras into the karaoke machines that he would have in the suites and record the goings on.
I would set up karaokes in the presidential suites. And then we would also have the cameras rolling. My butlers used to manage everything. Sex wasn't in the bedroom, it was everywhere. You're like a bunch of animals. I have a lot of those videos and pictures which we kept.
It's always great to see people when they're drunk, what they're capable of doing.
He made, you know, tens if not hundreds of millions of dollars of corrupt payments because he was able to overcharge for his services, and the Navy looked the other way because everyone was getting so many great gifts. And in return, those Navy officers helped to make sure that the ships that they were controlling went to ports that Leonard controlled so that he could charge more in those ports and basically rip off the US Navy. Leonard was eventually brought down by a woman called Marcy Mashevitz. She was the wife of a commander in the Navy, Commander Michael Mashevitz.
My name's Marcy Mashevitz. I'm a former Navy spouse. My ex-husband, Michael Mashevitz, was a prior enlisted sailor who climbed through the ranks and ended up the CO of a destroyer stationed out of Japan.
When Michael gets to Japan, he falls onto Leonard's radar. Leonard is always looking for people to corrupt, because if he can corrupt the people who control the ships, you know, he can get them into the ports where he can charge more money and he can get them to do things for him. And so Michael was important to him because Michael controlled the ship scheduling in Asia.
The Shepherds, he had value, you know. He was like the number two guy in the scheduling department.
So he corrupts him with prostitutes, with free vacations, and all of these kinds of things.
If you look at Mishevitz, he's actually a really nice guy. You know, a very gentle personality, friendly, great dad to his kids, womanizer.
Prosecutors say Fat Leonard and Misevich became close friends over private emails, calling each other Big Bro and Little Bro. The two men moved U.S. Navy ships around East Asia like chess pieces, using classified information, ending up at ports where Francis's firm would overbill the U.S.
Marcy at one point realizes that her husband, Commander Michael Mishevitz, is having multiple affairs with women, and she finds this, you know, very, very difficult to deal with. And she confronts Michael at one point about all of this. And one of their arguments gets pretty heated, and he ends up pushing her up the stairs, and she gets bruised.
So after the domestic issue, I just wanted to keep it kind of hush-hush for the sake of my family.
Then Marcy asks to go home to the U.S. because she doesn't want to be any more close to her now estranged husband. But the U.S. Navy declines to send her home.
After that domestic issue, about a week later, I was contacted by an agent with NCIS. Then they asked me to come down to the offices on base in Yokosuka, so I went a few days later, and again he asked me if I realized why I was there, and I said no, and it was kind of some back and forth, and finally I said, I really don't know why I'm here, so if there's a point to the interview, please get to it. And he said that they had received an anonymous tip that Michael was being investigated for espionage, and I said, no, I, you know, was not aware of that. And you know, the months went by, and then it came to the trip to Cambodia with the kids.
At one point, Michael had taken a vacation to Cambodia, paid for by Leonard, and he tells Marcy, oh, I'm here by means neither of us can talk about.
I flew his family back to Cambodia. I bought all the tickets and took his kids, flew them. I think it was twice, went back to Cambodia to visit his family.
As the saying goes, that was kind of the straw that broke the camel's back. And I went to his command with the information that I had and the stuff that I knew.
So she takes that to the NCIS and says, look, I think my husband is taking free trips from a contractor, and you know, I don't think that's right. And so she puts the Michael Mishevitz onto the radar of the investigators, and they start looking into his private emails, and from that they find out that he's been collaborating with Leonard.
So in the summer of 2012, the kids and I left Japan to move back to the States. I filed for divorce in spring of 2013. His arrest came in the fall of 2013, along with Leonard. It seems so silly now to say, but it's like, I didn't want my kids to have to say that their dad was in jail.
Dressed in civilian clothes for court.
I'm sorry, I can't comment.
Commander Michael Misevich had nothing to say about his role in a suspected multi-million-dollar international bribery scheme. Prosecutors say Commander Misevich received thousands of dollars in gifts.
So Leonard was arrested in 2013 in San Diego. He was lured there by the FBI and arrested in a sting. And 2 years later, he pleaded guilty. And for the last 6 years, he's been cooperating with the Department of Justice in their probe into all this fraud and all the people in the Navy that were involved in it. And what he says, and he says this in the podcast, is that there's been a cover-up, that all the information that he gave about, you know, the admirals for whom he organized prostitutes and the gifts that he gave them, they did not get punished, that only the lower-level guys got punished.
If the Navy would have charged every officer or admiral that were involved with me, the Navy would not have any more admirals left in the Navy. Everybody would have been put away.
So Leonard has been made to sit around and wait for so long because he can't be sentenced until everybody else is sentenced, because he's the star witness. And then he's also dying of kidney cancer. So it's an extraordinary circumstance. This story isn't over yet. Seven Navy officers who were involved with Leonard have pleaded not guilty, and they go to trial in February. But the government's case has been totally complicated by the fact that their star witness, Leonard, has decided to talk for this podcast. The most amazing thing about the Fat Leonard scandal is it really hasn't broken through to public consciousness. And, you know, what we've tried to do with the podcast is get it out there into the world because we believe it's one of our era's most undertold stories.